I want to continue to share with the body of Christ, not only here at our church, but around the world this morning. I want to share with you what God put on my heart last week, the message entitled, God Will Turn It Around. On a count of three, guys, with everything in your voice, when I count to three, I want you to shout and declare with your mouth. There's a miracle in your mouth. I want you to shout and declare when I count to three, God will turn it around. One, two, three. That's right. God will turn it around. Again, I'll never forget the words of my great spiritual father, one of them anyway, Bishop John Jimenez, the founder of the Rock Churches International around the world. Of course, the hub being in Virginia Beach, that his dear wife Ann Jimenez is still the senior pastor now that he's gone home to be with the Lord. Also, the one who birthed America for Jesus, where hundreds and thousands every year would gather in Washington. And his final words to the church and to America, of course, we know it by now, America, your house is on fire, but what's the next line out loud? There you go. You guys are good students. America, your house is on fire, but what are you going to do about it? Now, as you know, last week, history was made by the Supreme Court. The legalization of homosexual marriage is now a common law in every 50 state. And who would have ever imagined that we'd see these things coming to pass? Who would have imagined back in the 60s that prayer would be taken out of school? Who would have imagined in the 70s that a woman would have the right to choose whether she wants to allow her baby to live or die? Who would have ever imagined that Hitler was able to do what he did to assassinate Jews? Who would have imagined there would be a Mussolini? So folks, these things that we're sharing with you, these catastrophes, they're not new. They are not new. And the church has survived every horrific event in the world. Slavery, the abolishment of slavery. We've abolished everything. We've abolished everything. Are there issues? Yes, there are issues. But so long as our God is still on the throne, so long as he's still large and in charge, he will have the final say. Because I declare what the word of the Lord says, two words, Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Now, here's what we have to understand today. Here's where we can self-deceive ourselves. What do you mean by self-deceive? It's one thing when the devil deceives you. It's one thing when you see a tree filled with apples and the Lord says, eat from any tree except one. And then a serpent comes, a devil comes, and he tempts you. It's one thing to be tempted by the devil, but it's another thing to be tempted by your flesh. And many times it's your flesh that you're at war with. Many times it is a demon. Many times it is a principality, but many times it's our poor choices. Deuteronomy 30, 19, choose this day blessings. Choose this day life. And many things that happen in our life are predicated, not necessarily just because the devil attacked us, but many things happen to us in our lives based on the choices we make. This is why it says in Proverbs, Solomon said, take the wisdom of your father, your earthly father, your biological father, or your spiritual father, your heavenly father. Take the wisdom of your father, take it and bind it around your neck. Then he said, well, that sounds awful cruel. Let me tell you what the rest of the verse says. Bind it around your neck, for it will be life to you. God's not trying to strangle us. God's not trying to hurt us. But he's trying to contain us or retain us from making a straight path crooked. He wants to make that crooked path straight and keep it straight. The reason why he said, take that wisdom of a father and bind it around your neck so that road that was straight does not become crooked, but that crooked road becomes straight and it remains straight. So understand today, folks, while America is in another season of downfall, and we've been, it's not over the last 2 weeks, but let me tell you what really, well, I'll say the word, agitates me. What agitates me the most is not the downfall of America. I understand that. And that really bothers me. The country that I live in, those that served for me, that have gone to war on my behalf, those who came back from foreign soils and those that did not make it back, laying down their lives for our country. That bothers me, where America is and where America's going. And that should bother me, and I know it bothers you. But let me tell you something, and look at me very carefully. When I say look, I mean look spiritually at me. What bothers me more than homosexuality being legalized, and by the way, if you're gay, you've come to the right place. If you're an alcoholic or a drunk or a drug addict or had an abortion or had a premarital sex or fornication or adultery, you've come to the right place. Because I've got two words for you. Two words for you. Once again, Jesus saves. And he can set you free. And he can set us free. If you have a bad temper and you cannot control your temper, to where your wife said, if you do it one more time, I'm gone. Whoever you are, Jesus said, whosoever will may come. But when you come, be prepared to receive the love of Jesus, the power of God to set you free. Because whom the Son sets free is free indeed. So here's what bothers me or troubles me the most. What troubles me the most, and again, things trouble me, but what troubles me the most is not the state of the country. And again, watch me with spiritual eyes. And I know you are. You guys are the best. I got the blood of Jesus and the body of the Lord in front of me here representing. What bothers me as a man of God, as a prophetic watchman on the wall, according to the word of the Lord, as a watchman on the wall, one who has to see, one who has to speak things that sometimes I don't want to speak, one who has to see things that sometimes I do not want to see, but that goes with the prophetic territory. That's why the Bible says, surely the Lord does nothing unless he reveals his secrets, his mysteries to his servants, not his fly-by-nights, not his independent agents, but his servants, his prophets. Believe his prophets and you will prosper. The thing that concerns me the most is not the downfall of America. Obama is not my enemy. Homosexuals are not my enemy. The next president, whether him or her or a woman who thinks they're a man or a man who thinks they're a woman, the gay parade last week of over 1 million people on the city of Chicago, as much as it tries to really fill me with righteous indignation, and rightfully so, and all these catastrophes and so forth and so on, what troubles me the most, even more than that, you say, Pastor Jim, what can trouble you more than things that are legalized by the Supreme Court that God had to destroy a city over? What can trouble you more, man of God? I will tell you what troubles me more, or what can trouble me more, is when God's church slanders the world, goes on Facebook condemning this person, that thing. What I'm saying is this. It's one thing to stand for righteousness. It's another thing to bring condemnation. But now let me take it further, because I still not have told you. America, I still not have told you what troubles me the most. What troubles me the most is the very thing that troubles Jesus the most. Because remember, homosexuality is not a new thing. Not to be endorsed, not to be tolerated, but Sodom and Gomorrah. But what troubles me the most are the very things that Jesus said would take place before his return. And what troubles me the most, more than anything else, according to what Jesus says, is a lukewarm church. He said to the church, because of your lukewarmness, I'll spew you out of my mouth. He said to the church, sorry, I never knew you. But Lord, I prophesied in your name. I gave accurate words in your name. Sorry, I never knew you. What troubles me the most, according to Matthew 25, is that there were 10 virgins. Virginity represents purity. Virginity means I'm part of the church and I look clean and I act that way. But when the groom and the bride came to meet together, 5 of the church were taken and 5 were left behind. 5 went up and 5 stayed back. People that paid their tithe, gave their first fruits every month, sowed their seed, and even partook of the Lord's Supper. Now let me tell you something. I heard people say God caused that earthquake and God caused 9/11. And God's judgment came on September 11, 2001 and killed nearly 3,000 people. Let me ask you a question. Do your children deserve to be in prison if they're innocent? Yes or no? Come on. Yes or no? Do your children at home, let's take it to your house, do your children at home deserve to be reprimanded and punished and have rights taken away from them if they've not misbehaved? Why would you want to punish your child if he's innocent? Why would you want to show severe judgment to your loved one if all she's doing is pleasing you? Now, it doesn't make your daughter perfect. It doesn't make your son perfect. So I say to you, why would God destroy Christians? Many of those people on 9/11, almost 3,000, many of them were born again, spirit-filled, tongue-talking. They attended churches in New York City that I used to preach in. Why then would God send judgment upon his innocent children who are saved, sanctified, and covered with the blood of Jesus? Why would he? That would make him an abusive father. That would make him an abusive daddy. Now listen to me. Judgment is coming to America. But judgment will not come to the church unless there's a remnant, unless there are people who are called by his name. May I make myself perfectly clear? Being in a room this morning is not a ticket out. It's not a free ticket out. Taking communion this morning is not an escape out. Putting an offering on the altar is not a way out. The way out is living a holy, sanctified, committed life to Jesus, the Christ, the Son of the living God. And I can only live this life. I can only live this life by the grace of God. I can only live it knowing that his mercies are new every morning. I do not have the ability. I did not have the ability to save me. And I do not have the ability to keep me saved. Only but the blood of Jesus. Not by might, not by power, but by my spirit. So I submit to you today, judgment of God will come upon America. Judgment of God will come upon Hollywood. Judgment of God will come upon New York City and Wall Street. It will come. But for the child of God, he separates the 5 wise from the 5 foolish. And my biggest concern today is not getting mad at the world. Not getting mad at people. Folks, you ought to be mad. You ought to have anger. The Bible says, be angry. It says it. Be angry, but sin not. But your anger needs to be vented not just on Facebook, but it needs to be vented on your knees. I'll say it again. Church, are you among us? You're venting. Your venting should be done in the secret place of the Most High. Your venting should be done on a Wednesday night in prayer meeting. So I cry out to you. I cry out to you on behalf of my Father who's in heaven, Bishop John Jimenez, whose natural body has died, but his spiritual body lives. And it lives in one of the persons called me, and there are many others. America, your house is on fire. What are you going to do about it? So before you make a false Facebook post bashing people, before you start complaining about this one and that one, and we don't stand for unrighteousness, please do not hear what I'm not saying. Why don't we use, and here's a word that the devil's tried to pervert, but I don't care, I'm going to say it anyway. Use your energy. When I say energy, I'm not talking about your new age energy, new religion energy. I say use your energy, use your strength to ask, seek, knock, keep knocking. Like that woman with the issue of blood, she used all her energy. Like blind Bartimaeus, Jesus, Son of David, use your energy, use your strength. Not to be part of the problem. And again, we're not endorsing racism. We're not endorsing homosexuality. We're not endorsing lesbianism. We're not endorsing adultery, fornication. On the contrary. But let the church use its time. If time is valuable and you believe it, if Jesus is coming soon and you believe it, if he said, occupy till I come, and you believe it, if he said, I must work the work of him who sent me while it's day, and if you believe it, then there's got to be an urgency within your spirit. And today is no different than 2,000 years ago. Five in the church looked good, acted good, smelled good, put on a good show, but in the end, they lack substance. But God also had five wise virgins. Now let me tell you something about the five wise virgins. They're far from perfect. They make mistakes. But the five wise have an urgency. No different than you smell gas in your house, and instantly you have an urgency to see where that smell's coming from. Or a fire! A fire erupts in your house, and you have an urgency. Or you found out that one of your loved ones is in a coma. You have an urgency. You found out that the woman's about to give birth and they're having a problem delivering this baby and they don't know if the baby's going to come out alive or dead. There's an urgency. Well, I speak today prophetically. This does not win friends and influence people. I know it. I'm not here to make friends. I'm here to make disciples. This does not build bigger buildings. I'm not here to build a building. I'm here to build the kingdom. Urgency. Do you have it? Urgency. Do you have it? Do you really have it? I was born for such a time as this. Earlier you watched a video of 58 years. It was cute and fun, I understand. But for me, it's history. It's me, it's my DNA. It's my lineage. There's a reason why I was born into a third generation Pentecostal home for such a time as this. There's a reason God kept me alive on November 11th, 2005, when I could not breathe for 2 minutes. There's a reason for such a time as this. That's who I'm concerned about. When I see people using their energy and their fingers, sometimes I want to take their fingers and I'll tell you what I want to do with them. And they're posting this and posting that. And I'm looking, I can only imagine how God feels. Why don't we use our time, folks? Why don't we use our resources? After all, we do have the third person of the Godhead living inside of us. Why don't we get him stimulated in us so that rather than condemning or thinking the next president is going to be the answer, folks, hear me, read my lips, it will only get worse. But there is a church. Hantakalo shapa santo mendeke pesente. Proshante kitem mende pratakota pasante. There is a church. Whether you're a part of it, that's your call. There's a people. There are five virgins that are wise. You decide. There are five virgins that are foolish. You decide. They all come together. They all look alike. They all act alike until Christ comes. And then you know the five wise from the five foolish. That's why Jesus said the wheat grows with the tares. The wheat grows with the weeds. Hear me. The wheat grows with the weeds. They live among each other. They're relatives, they're friends, they're co-mates, they're co-workers. They sit together in church. They sing together in the choir. And they grow together. And you cannot tell them apart. The wheat, the fiber. The fiber that flushes the body. And the wheat and the weeds, they grow together. But the Lord says that in time, the weeds will grow. And many times, hear me, the weeds grow faster than the wheat. And some may have this illusion. As God said in His Word, I'll bring a delusion. Some have this illusion that the one who's growing faster, the one who has a bigger church, the one who's on the cover of more Christian magazines, apparently she must be doing something better or something right. That's an illusion because of a delusion. That's an illusion because of a delusion. But the Bible says those wheats will grow, and those weeds will grow, and sometimes those weeds will outgrow the wheat. And that wheat may be thinking, but Lord, did you forget me? But that wheat is smart enough that it grows internally. My. The weeds grow externally. But the wheat internally. That's why when somebody who lives like a weed, when a tragedy takes place, they go crazy. I mean ballistic. I mean, listen, there's a time to weep, there's a time to mourn, but some people just go crazy. Where Jesus says, peace, be still. Peace, be still. A wheat will grow, and sometimes it'll grow slowly, but it'll grow accordingly. But the weeds keep growing and growing and growing. And many times, there's so many weeds that you cannot tell the difference. Hear me, I'm talking to the church. I'm talking to you, America. Sometimes, the weeds grow so much quicker and they're more massive than the actual wheat that suddenly, sometimes, you cannot separate the weeds from the wheat. And then eventually, if not careful, the weeds take over. And if not careful, everything gets plucked together, like throwing the baby out with the bath water. The weeds, let me tell you this, hear the word of the Lord, weeds are to be plucked out. Wheat is to be pruned. Because anything that God prunes reproduces. And His desire is to take the weeds from the root. Today I'm speaking root conscious. Because unless you deal with, why am I so strong? Why am I so loud? Because when you deal with weeds, you got to go down into some dirty trenches. You have to see some ugly things. In weeks from now, you're going to be parking your vehicle in a beautiful parking lot. Isn't that exciting? Isn't that great? But you'll see the finished product. But if you go there now, you'll see dirt. You'll see a mess. You'll see mud. You'll see ugly things. Ugly things. They were there the other day. Some of the construction workers, they found marijuana pipes in the backyard. Who knows, from years ago. Certainly wasn't the church, I'm sure. They found old golf clubs. They found old articles. Let me tell you something. When you start to dig stuff up in your life, some things will come to surface. It may not look nice. It may not smell pretty. But when you are a weed, you will go quicker. You will go quicker, apparently, seemingly, than a wheat. The weed will. But God says, I want to take that weed and pluck it. Today, God, I stand before this Holy Communion. God wants to pluck out every weed from your life so that the world will know that you're not a weed that gets in the way and is a... Weeds are nuisances. I have my lawn 6 times a year treated. 6 times a year. True green. Ask me how much it costs. That's another favorable story we'll save for another day. I have my grass treated 6 times a year. From weeds, from grubs, to dandelions. Yeah, those pretty little things that I used to bring home to my mama and say, here, mama. Weeds. Weeds. And let me tell you something right now in the body of Christ. Christians cannot even have enough discernment to recognize who's a Christian and who's not. The 10 were all together in the same place, hearing the same preacher. Today, in July 2015, the same preacher with the same red shoes and the same wild-looking shirt, I speak the word of the Lord. It's time to separate the wheat from the tares. And you know that when there's an urgency placed within you. Now, unfortunately, God, who's a God of mercy, He never wants to see any disaster take place to anybody. But sometimes, because He loves us so much, because one of His name that starts with a J, and I'm not saying Jesus, although His name is Jesus, there's another J word for Him, and I want you to tell the world when I count the three out loud what that J name is. 1, 2, 3.
Jealous.
His name is jealous. It's one thing to be jealous. It's another thing to have the nature of jealousy. To have the nature of jealousy. So God, in this hour, nothing has caught Him by surprise. Men thinking they're women. Women thinking they're men. Women thinking they're animals, having tails put on artificially on their backside. All this is happening in America. It's atrocious. Hear me. It's atrocious, and it is an abomination. But to not one of these, hear me, and it's all an abomination, but not to one of these did He say, because of your lukewarmness, I'll spit you out of my mouth. Understand. For God to regurgitate something, Jesus that is, for Him to throw up, vomit, regurgitate, your pick. For Him to throw up, regurgitate, or vomit means something has to be inside of Him. We could say all day we want, I am in Christ, and Christ is in me. The proof is not just in your confession, but in the reality of choosing, being wise, or being foolish. Because let me tell you something. No matter how nice you dress, no matter how pretty the cologne smells, any and everything, at the end of the day, you cannot hide one thing. You could try to wear belts and whatever you ladies wear to make your stomach skinnier, and that's all fine. I'm sure when you get home, you rip that stuff off and you say, oh, thank you, Jesus. Whoo, I could be me again. Take that makeup off. Take what they call skanks? Spanx. You ought to be spanked with that skank. skanked with this. But at the end of the day, when you take that, hey, listen, I was born in 57. My mother wore a girdle. Do they still make girdles? The true story, I remember when I was 4 years old, my mother would wear a girdle, and they had those little loops on the bottom, and then she'd wear nylon stockings, and they had to be attached to the girdle. And I would help her. I would go around my mom's body, and I would help her with those loops. Ladies, you've come a long way. So you can go home today, you can take that makeup off, you can take that piece off, you can... You like that, Titus? That was pretty good, huh? If you can get a Filipino to laugh, that's a miracle. All right. I remember going to the Philippines. One of my favorite people in the world are the Filipinos. I remember going there as a New York Italian, an Italian New Yorker. And I, you know, this is me. And I come the way I come. And, you know, I hug people. I kiss people. I spit when I talk. You better be careful with the Lord's Supper today, okay? But I did not understand the culture. I did not understand the culture and, you know, how they sometimes talk with their eyes. And they mean as much respect. They mean to be as respectful and loving as anybody. But I didn't know sometimes they talk with their eyes or they give eyebrows up. And some hug. I understand that. And you guys hug. You show affection. You do. I'm speaking nice, okay? And you got to stay here anyway. The last church you left, you came back. Okay, so now it's time to stay. Okay, here we go. Okay. Gloriana, did that get you to laugh? Did that make you laugh? Well, the fact that your mama passed away yesterday and you can laugh today, it was worth me saying. I love Filipinos. I love anything in a can. I love Mexicans, Puerto Ricans, Africans, Filipino cans, any kind of cans. But anyway, what I'm saying is, when all our makeup is off, and all our dew is done, the dew is done, at the end of the day, did we become wheat? Fiber. Fiber is used to flush the body, to clean the church. Or were they weeds? And the Lord says, in the last days, you will not be able to separate the wheat from the tares. I don't think I did. If I did I even open up a Bible to share with you any verses today? Did I? Did I give you any verses? I did not. I just quoted, but I didn't give you any verses, did I? I spoke out of the abundance of the reservoir of what's already in me. The word of the Lord says, thy word have I hidden in my heart. Did I give you the word? I just felt the Lord say, close your Bible. They got it. Now look at me, precious darlings, please. Jesus said, I did not come to condemn you, but to bring you peace. So this morning, as his ambassador to this region, to this church, and to this nation, I don't come to condemn you. But I've come to raise the trumpet and the clarion call. Jesus is coming. Jesus is coming back. And he's coming back sooner than you realize. When I was a little boy, I was told Jesus is coming back. And he still has not. But guess what? I'm 50 years closer. But I'm telling you something. This I know by the Spirit. He will not permit America to keep getting away what they think it's getting away with. He's going to come back soon. This is what I do know. He will judge the world. Those actors and actresses, unless they get born again, and I have nothing against actors and actresses. Some of them make me laugh. But many that deny the Lord, who curse his name, who hold up their Oscar and take this is their words, effing Jesus Christ, and shove it up your unless they're saved. Sometimes I feel like Peter in the Garden of Gethsemane. You know, he took Malchus and he cut his ear off. Sometimes I feel like Peter, I just want to open up a can. But then I got to realize, I don't represent Peter. Catholics, in all due respect, I do not represent Peter. I represent Peter's older brother, the Lord Jesus. So as Jesus would speak, I'm coming back like a thief in the night. Like Jesus would said, they were all together on a Sunday morning, but five were weeds, distractions, appeared successful. What's your formula for your life in church growth and happiness? How can I live my best years in fun and now? What Jesus said, I must pick up my cross every day and deny myself and follow him. And the world behind me, the cross before me, not the world before me, the cross behind me. So my cry to America today is, my cry to you, my dearly beloved, on this 4th of July weekend, which I'm so blessed to see you all, my cry to you is, are you wheat or are you weeds? Now, some of you may think, well, Pastor Jim, you've known me for 15 years. Please, I'm not segregating. Please, no favoritisms, not today. Remember, God has no grandchildren. So I talk to you as a unit, as one body. If I wanted to take you all individually, I can tell you, like a doctor can tell a patient about their body, I can tell you about your spiritual walk. But I'm not here to do that today. I'm here to gather you as one unit and say, if you've been part of the weed crowd, get rid of it. It may cause success, it's temporary. It may cause fame, it's temporary. Get back to your roots. Be the wheat. You may not be noticed like others, but you'll be healthy. You'll be nutritious. Because the wheat are those that live with an urgency of the hour. We're not perfect, nor do we allow the devil to bring condemnation upon us. We know there's still junk in our trunk, but we know we are what we are by the grace of God. We know that we're going to be like the five wise, not the five foolish. We know that when the Son of Man returns, we're not going to be left behind. The Bible says in Matthew 24, not to be confused with Matthew 25, two will be walking up a hill, one will be taken, and the other left. Two will be grinding at the mill. The mill, the wheat, the mill. Two will be grinding at the mill. One will be taken and the other left. Two will be sleeping in bed. One will be taken, the other left. And the interesting thing is, in Jesus, in red letters in Matthew 24, was talking to all of us. To all of us. Including those in this building today. All of us. Including you, those of you watching right now. You. Yeah, you too. Me. Yeah, you. All of us. So today, I just wanted to come on this 4th of July weekend and introduce you or reintroduce you to what real freedom is all about. What real liberty is all about. So that we can see, and most of all the world, in the darkest hour, can see spiritual fireworks that will blow them away. And God's counting on you. This has been the word of the Lord.